On a December morning in 1949, distinguished by unusual warmth and blinding sunlight, emerging like a narrative from ages past, the Panagyurishte treasure was discovered. The Deikovi brothers, Pavel, Petko, and Mikhail, stumbled upon this remarkable find while working near a field, as their shovels revealed a hidden cavity filled with metal objects adorned with a faint golden sheen beneath layers of clay and dirt. After washing the artifacts in the river, the brothers were momentarily dazzled by the exquisite craftsmanship and beauty revealed. This discovery marked the beginning of a story that would captivate the world, sparking questions about the origins of the artifacts, the craftsmen behind them, and the messages they were meant to convey across ages. David Rockefeller, an industrial titan and philanthropic icon, was captivated by the treasure, drawn not only to its historical significance, but possibly to a deeper, hidden meaning or power encoded in its creation. We introduce a magnificent set of Thracian gold, consisting of 9 ancient vessels weighing 6,158 kilo. However, a historical puzzle arises when archaeologist Petar Gorbanov records the treasure's weight as 7.5 kilos on the day of discovery, presenting a baffling discrepancy of about 1.5 kilos. Our forthcoming video segment promises to explore this mystery and other enthralling secrets concealed within this ancient treasure. Gorbanov's analysis dates the treasure to around 400 BC, an assessment that has yet to be challenged. Despite limited research on the treasure, it's widely speculated to predate the 3rd or 4th century BC, making this gold set a unique find with no known counterparts worldwide. This uniqueness poses a complex yet intriguing challenge in deciphering the treasure, a challenge we will address in our video's final part. Archaeologists theorize that the treasure was crafted using the ancient method of hammering gold leaves, with the most mysterious item being created through another, as yet unknown, technique. As mentioned, the set comprises 9 items, 7 rhytons, 1 amphora, and 1 phiale. It is the phiale that differs in its craftsmanship from the other artifacts. Initially displayed in the city center, the 9 artifacts were later moved to the Archaeological Museum in Plovdiv. They remained there until 1975, when a prominent philanthropist and industrial magnate personally transported them to the USA on his private jet. This man was David Rockefeller. In April 1975, David Rockefeller's private jet touched down at Sofia Airport, signaling a visit purported to bolster US-Bulgarian relations under the then communist regime. Despite the visit's official rationale sparking debate, it culminated in Rockefeller channeling approximately $400 million into Bulgaria's economy, notably in tobacco production and processing. This investment, well documented and enduring, has led to the establishment of 2 key buildings in Sofia, thanks to the generous support of the wealthy family: the National Center for Infectious and Parasitic Diseases, and the Biological Faculty at Sofia University. During an official reception hosted by Bulgaria's head of state, Todor Zhivkov, Rockefeller's expressed interest in the Panagyurishte treasure prompted swift action. Zhivkov ordered state security to retrieve the treasure from the museum in Plovdiv, foregoing the usual formalities of documentation. However, the story doesn't end there. Witnesses at the scene report that upon seeing the treasure, Rockefeller bowed to the golden phial, making strange gestures that some interpreted as Masonic. Although we cannot confirm this information, the symbolism in the items, especially in the phiale, is indeed intriguing and will be explored later in the video. Despite being a priceless national treasure, Rockefeller insisted on taking the treasure back with him to the USA. After his return to USA, he made a replica for himself, and the original was handed over to the Metropolitan Museum in New York. The Metropolitan Museum started producing replicas, as they had no contract with Bulgaria, and began auctioning them off, making a significant profit from about 12 to 15 copies. Years later, the Bulgarian state established a cultural heritage fund to search worldwide for evidence, archives, documents, and artifacts of Bulgarian identity. In 1982, as a result of intelligence service activities, Rockefeller was compelled to return the treasure to Bulgaria. On June 30th, Richard Nixon, the former President of the United States, also on a private visit to Bulgaria, personally returned the gold treasure to Zhivkov. After a whole 7 years, the treasure is returned. But is the returned item the original? Before we answer this question, let's pose another. Why did Rockefeller want it? To address this inquiry, we need to explore the fascinating world of the Thracians and uncover the elusive messages within the Panagyurishte gold treasure. Prominent thracologists have formulated the hypotheses we will discuss, yet many of these interpretations continue to be subjects of debate among scholars. The Thracian master craftsman priests transmitted their messages through profound symbolism, accessible only to those enlightened by the ancient world. The Panagyurishte gold treasure should be viewed as a book with 9 chapters, starting with the amphora, an unparalleled masterpiece of Thracian art. There are several interpretations of the frieze's content. One theory suggests it portrays a scene from the ancient Greek myth, the Seven Against Thebes, where 7 heroes attack the fortress gate. Another interpretation sees it as depicting a funeral ritual with a war dance performed at the entrance to a Thracian tomb. A third interpretation proposes that the amphora rhytons frieze depicts scenes from the life and feats of the ancient Greek hero Hercules. The scene at the door is linked to his descent into the underworld of Hades, a realm he is said to have visited at least twice in Greek narratives. In 1958, Hoffman highlighted the distinctive clubs featured as part of the armament of 2 figures in the frieze. From ancient depictions, it is known that the individual wielding such a club, identified as a cudgel, mace, or club, is the Greek hero Hercules. Mythology recounts how Hercules crafted his mighty weapon from an ash tree he uprooted in the Nemean forest. The figures at the bottom find their explanation in the stories about the hero, confirming him as the central figure in the imagery. The goddess Hera, who despised Zeus and Alcmene's son, sought to destroy him by releasing 2 large snakes into Hercules' cradle. However, he grabbed one in each hand and strangled them. The centaurs on the handles of the amphora rhyton are not merely decorative. Their presence is linked to Hercules' feat following Eurystheus's order to bring back the ferocious Erymanthian boar which lived in Mount Erymanthus in Arcadia and ravaged the vicinity of the nearby city of Trophis. In fulfilling this command, Hercules had to battle the centaurs, whom he defeated. There is much more information and analysis available regarding this hypothesis. If you're interested in a deeper dive into the amphora's mysteries and the stories it holds, please let us know in the comments. Let's delve further into the 3 female rhytons, distinguished by their sphinx-shaped handles. Various interpretations exist regarding the figures depicted on these rhytons. Some view them as representations of the triple goddess or the great mother goddess, symbolizing comprehensive divine femininity. There's also speculation that the rhytons feature Amazons or the divine trio of Athena, Hera, and Aphrodite. Featuring Hera makes sense within the treasure's narrative, as she famously dispatched the 2 snakes that a young Hercules overcame, a scene depicted on the amphora. Among the hypotheses, the depiction of the great Hecate stands out intriguingly. Known as the goddess of the sky, earth, and underworld, Hecate's traditional portrayal with 3 heads, a snake, a horse, and a dog, suggests a multifaceted deity. Within the Panagyurishte gold treasure, the 3 female heads on the rhytons might present a more refined vision of Hecate, diverging from her usual animal-headed representations and offering a unique perspective on her divine aspects. There's something very intriguing depicted on one of the female rhytons, accompanied by an inscription, which has sparked numerous speculations. We'll discuss this in detail at the end of the video. The next four rhytons are incredibly beautiful and detailed, shaped as animal heads, specifically a ram, a goat, and two with fallow deer heads. Their upper parts are adorned with mythological scenes and characters from ancient Greek mythology. The first rhyton, shaped like a young ram's head, is notable for the budding horns. It features an opening on its lower jaw and a lion-shaped handle. A depicted scene shows Dionysus on a throne, scepter in hand, with a woman identified as Eriope embracing him. Surrounding them, maenads engage in a lively dance. It is believed that the lamb's head rhyton symbolizes the quest for the golden fleece. Another rhyton is shaped like a deer on which four figures are depicted. Paris Alexander stands, surrounded by the seated goddesses Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite. This scene represents the judgment of Paris from the myth of the Trojan War, favored by the Thracian aristocracy. Scenes on another deer rhyton celebrate the feats of Hercules and Theseus, Greece and Attica's legendary heroes. Their joint ventures include the quest for the Golden Fleece and battles against the Amazons. The final rhyton, without a handle, features a goat's protome. Ionic dialect inscriptions reveal a scene with Hera, Apollo, Artemis, and Nike, suggesting a unique Thracian narrative rooted in Dionysian rituals, with the goat symbolizing the deity, a motif recurring in Thracian artifacts. We now reach the most intriguing piece, the phiale, where the mystery of its purpose and symbolism is vast. It resembles a flat dish with a 25-centimeter diameter and a 3-centimeter height. It features 12 ivy fruit clusters, a wreath of 24 leaves, and 72 faces, all except the fruits arranged in four concentric circles, with plant ornaments between each element. Initially thought to be a ritual drinking vessel, a later hypothesis suggested a divinatory use, proposing that liquid was poured against the sun to allow ritual participants to observe the light through the vessel's bottom. These are merely hypotheses. However, the symbolism here is striking and will let the numbers speak for themselves. Firstly, it's impossible not to mention that the human faces on the phiale have negroid features. Some interpret these as faces of African slaves, others as Atlanteans. Supporters of the Atlantean faces compare them with other similar features not native to the region where they were found, notably the Olmec heads from Central America, making the facial resemblance quite interesting. Another popular hypothesis suggests the heads belong to Ethiopians. In his treatise on Isis and Osiris, Plutarch writes about the murder of Osiris, presenting him as a teacher and bearer of civilization. Osiris became king and rid the Egyptians of their primitive, savage customs and practices, taught them to cultivate grains, established laws for them, and instructed them in the worship of gods. When Set organized a conspiracy against him, there were 72 accomplices, led by a queen from Ethiopia named Aso. The 72 negroid heads on the phiale are Set's servants who killed Osiris, with Aso also present in a coded form on the reverse side of the phiale. This raises the question of whether the phiale's origin might trace back to ancient Egypt, as when examining the gilded carvings on the throne of the 18th dynasty pharaoh Tutankhamun, we find behind him and his wife a round vessel resembling the phiale with a soaked lotus. The pharaoh's phiale also has four concentric circles, with a lotus submerged in the center. It's crucial to mention that the phiale is crafted differently from the other long gold items in the set. It's the only item whose material isn't from the region, made, according to some, from monoatomic gold, making it exceedingly valuable. Unfortunately, there are no studies on the gold's composition or craftsmanship, leaving us with mere speculation. At the beginning, we mentioned that the total weight on the day of its discovery was approximately 7 kilograms and 500 grams. This is an intriguing fact, as the weight of the treasure has drastically changed over the years. Official sources state that the initial measurement was conducted using a primitive scale, which they claim accounts for the discrepancy. It's up to you to decide whether you believe this explanation. It's also interesting that exact gold replicas cannot be made with the same weight as the originals. Even the most precise replicas are significantly heavier. How the ancient craftsmen achieved such perfection remains a mystery. I will share another intriguing detail with you. One of the three female rhytons features additional decoration. It has elements with symbolic significance. On the back of the more distinctive female figure, there are carved stars which are claimed to represent the constellation Sirius. There is also the word Khan, meaning ruler, whose authority is bestowed by the great architect of the universe. As promised at the beginning, I will allow myself to share one of the speculative theories that might explain Rockefeller's desire to own the treasure. If the phial is made of monoatomic gold, we should explore its properties. It is known to lose weight at 400 degrees Celsius and is also believed to boost the ability to receive information from human DNA. It is claimed that through the phiale and adherence to ancient rituals, one can access the information field of the universal mind, potentially increasing lifespan. Is this what Rockefeller had in mind? He passed away at the age of 101 on March 20, 2017, and had a replica of the treasure for his personal use. Some even suspect that the original remained with him. Fortunately, during the treasure's seizure in 1975, a museum employee in Plovdiv chipped off a piece from the ear of one of the rhytons and preserved it as a reference sample. In 2015, scientists, after a series of studies on the treasure and comparing it with this sample, concluded that it is 100% original. This raises the question, how did they determine the phiale to be original when its composition differs from the rest of the items? I'd love to hear your insights on this topic in the comments below. For those keen on exploring more about the Thracians and their enigmatic history, check out our video on Perperikon, their ancient city. The link is in the description. Looking forward to our next encounter.